is about $20 a barrel after all the investments have been done. But still, if you sell it at 60 or 70, you're doing very well. But I don't believe the Iranians or the Chinese who are now in Venezuela trying to do that have the technology and the even the financial capability to do what it needs to be done. And even if they did, it would certainly take much more than 3, 4, 5 years. You don't develop an oil field in 2, 3, 4, 5 years. You need 10 years or so. Incidentally, when the Cubans say that they have a lot of oil in their offshore, by the time they develop the oil, if the oil is really there, it will take about 10 or 12 years. And my assumption is in 10 or 12 years, the Castros might not be in power, although who knows? So.
Luis, please.
Venezuela? Yeah, in the very short term, again, Chavez can do a lot of things. He has this lot of money still in his pockets. So right now, for example, he increased the salaries of the public employees in 40%. 40%. This is an increase which has no logic except to make these people who are about 1.5 million public employees in Venezuela happy just before the elections. And he has, he's buying weapons for the military. As you know, to buy a tank, a new airplane or a new tank for the military is like buying a toy for your child. Is something that to play with, because Venezuela has never had a war, never. And yet he has been buying already about $8 billion worth of weapons from Russia and China and Iran and so on. So he can still do a lot with his money to prepare, because Venezuelans are very, they only see the very short term. Well, most people tend to do that, but Venezuelans are even worse than most. So they say, well, today we are fine, tomorrow who knows? And that's a philosophy that is good for Chavez. But in spite of that, he's going to lose a lot of ground in November.
Yes, John.
Well, as you know, Leopoldo López was a big favorite, except that he was invalidated by Chavez precisely because he was a good favorite. And Manuel Rosales in Zulia is now being accused of trying to kill Chavez because he's doing well at the polls. So what we are seeing in Venezuela is a process that is going from intimidation to terror. And it has never become real terror in Venezuela for, well, at least for many years. Only in the 19th century we had terror. But under Chavez, if he is really threatened, he will resort to terror.
Yes, please, could you identify yourself?
Sure. After the last referendum, a lot of people took a political stand in the military, started to please put down the finding standing of Chavez. There have been indications since then that, on the contrary, Chavez had expanded and consolidated.
Well, two things. The security aspect, Chavez is losing control on the security aspect, mostly because the security rings, so to speak, are more and more controlled by Cuba through their agents and people in place in Venezuela. And to say that they are controlled by Cuba doesn't mean that Chavez should be feeling safe, because Raúl Castro is very different, at least in his objectives, to Fidel's objectives. Raúl Castro doesn't like Chavez. So I don't know. If I was Chavez, I wouldn't use a Cuban barber. And that's as far as security is concerned. But the military, within the military, there are deep cleavages. The lower ranks in the military are very unhappy. And when the lower ranks in the Venezuelan military are unhappy, that means that they can rebel at any moment. I mean, military rebellions in Venezuela are never led by high-ranking officers. They are led by low-ranking officers. Even when Chavez tried to rebel, he was a very low commander or something like that. So, So right now, the problem is that if you have enough money, you can keep everybody happy at the same time. When you don't have enough money, you start cutting money to some. And those some are going to be unhappy. And right now, the unhappy ones are becoming the low-rank military, because the high-rank military are very happy. They are getting the bulk of the money. So I wouldn't put too much faith on the unity or loyalty of the military or even the security agents in Venezuela.
Gustavo, we have one more question, and then we're going to take a short break.
I just want one brief comment. One of the really interesting things in the Reyes documents is that they say we haven't told the Cubans about this when they're dealing with Chavez. They make it explicit that they're going to have to, they said we'll have to send someone to inform the Cubans later after it's a done deal. So there's clearly, with his relationship with the FARC was not entirely above board with the Cubans. The other thing you see with the military is that he's franchising out different ports for cocaine trafficking, which is a huge income for those particular commanders. My understanding is that Chavez doesn't benefit directly from those, but also in the FARC documents, they talk about the changes coming and who their friends will be at different ports so they can walk in easily and how much they're going to have to pay them. And so they're franchising out the drug distribution to pay certain military units, I think, quite a lucrative sum of money over time, which may replace the oil money in some sense for keeping things going.
Thank you. Okay. One last question. Yes, Luis, go ahead.